So now we are continuing, and the Mimer Lessons in Sefer Heichaltzu of the Rebbe Rashab. We're holding by chapter 6. We just learned last week differences between Chachma and Bina, that both of them are intellectual faculties, where Chachma, you can't even put it into words. There's just a complete nullification. And being so bitzel, that's basically the level that stems for Ahavas Yisrael. And Bina, there are different, all kinds of different ideas. But nevertheless, this could create division if the Bina is done improperly. It'll create division. If Bina is processed properly, it'll categorize many different components, but they will all work together to reach the idea that Chachma is trying to reach in the first place. For instance, I brought an example of this on YouTube. If you have two Chabad houses, let's say three Chabad houses in a community, and each one is competing against the other Chabad house and not leaving room for another Chabad house, it makes it very difficult for that community to grow. No, this is factual. This is very factual. If you have three Chabad houses, like what happened in Las Vegas, you had Rabbi Harlick, you had Rabbi Shanowitz, you had the other Rabbi Harlick, and you had Rabbi Bronstein. You get four Chabad houses, but they all work under one roof because there's not a lot of Jews in the beginning, and they all work together. Do you know what happened in Las Vegas? There was kosher restaurants opening everywhere. There was two mikvahs opening up. There was a Chabad Hebrew school that branched out into an academy. There was a Jewish community, two Jewish communities, very big and flourishing. There's Jewish communities. There's Sopharis. There's everything in Las Vegas because when people saw the collaboration and everybody working together, it boomed, becoming one of the largest Jewish communities in the United States. But then there's another community, I'm not speaking Lashon Hara, they didn't work together, and yet they still struggle to get a minyan. In other words, if you have 10 different components and they work together, one's a carpenter, one's a sofer, one builds houses, whatever. Everyone has their own little thing that they do. Huh? Everybody has their own individual yeshus. But if they take their individual yeshus and work for the same goal, then you build a community. If you don't leave room for someone else and you're competing and you're not making room for anybody else, then you cannot build a community. There can only be one carpenter. Why can't there be two? If you have two carpenters and you have five house builders, then you could build more Jewish houses and communities. If you have everybody competing and stabbing each other in the back, you won't grow. That's the point. Same thing with Chachma and Bina. There has to be a bunch of different ideas, and they have to work together to reach the same goal as Chachma. Now, we're starting chapter 6. In the previous chapter, the Rebbe Rashab explained that there are two approaches to division. One that leads to strife and separation. See, that's exactly what I was talking about. And a second that makes possible a comprehensive state of unity. That's when they're all working together in a state of bitzel. He develops this concept further in the chapter that follows, introducing the fundamental theme of the mimer. That difference needs not lead to division among people, and that a community can attain true oneness when each of its members develops his potential and simultaneously recognizes the need to bond with others. To clarify further the concept of division, which brings about unity mentioned in the previous chapter. Concealed within every entity is its antithesis. Gam ha-koichos ha-atzmim. This is true even of the soul's essential powers. In Chassidus, the term atzmi, translated as essential, is often used in a general sense to refer to levels of the soul or godly light that are not specific in nature, but rather refer to these powers or light as they're subsumed in their source to the extent that their individual identity is not felt. In the context of this mimer, the term essential powers refers to the original potential for the powers of our souls as they exist in a preconscious state. The Rebbe Rishab is emphasizing that the interrelation of the soul's powers with each other does not apply only on a conscious level, but even as they exist in their very source. Yesh b'chol echad mehem ha'his kalus mehakoyach ha'haf ki, each of which has its antithesis incorporated within it. Here the Rebbe Rishab is speaking about a level on which the powers of the soul, although they are in a preconscious state, have begun to assume an individual identity. Even so, incorporated within each power is its antithesis. Behind you, mitzad ha'atzmus shelamai lagam mehakoychos atzmi. This is so by virtue of the soul's essence, which transcends even its essential powers. Diva ha'atzmus yeshnam kulam bivichinas hiskalus mamash, and contains all of them in perfect synthesis. The Rebbe Rishab is referring to a concept explained in detail in other sources of Chassidus. The essence of the soul is a simple, singular entity above all identification with specific powers or qualities. Every person has a fundamental I that cannot be quantified or described in any manner or form. Like everybody has a sense of self. It is a spark of godliness, and like God, is unlimited, uncompounded, and undefined. However, as a person functions in his everyday life, he uses various powers, such as intellect and emotion. The relationship between these powers and the essence of the soul requires detailed explanation. On one hand, these powers are very different from the essence of the soul. They have a specific identity and definition, each related to the function it performs. On the other hand, it cannot be said that their source is outside the essence of the soul. Were that to be true, it would be difficult to understand how they became implanted within the soul. Accordingly, Chassidus explains that within the essence of the soul, there exists all the different potentials and powers that are later revealed. However, they exist as potentials rather than distinct entities. Indeed, the use of the term potential has to be clarified because a potential does in fact exist, though it has not become actual. Chassidus explains this via the analogy of fire within a coal. Although the fire is not evident or visible, it exists as a separate entity distinct from the coal. Thus, the analogy is not an entirely appropriate description of the manner in which our different powers exist in the essence of the soul. For the essence of the soul is, as stated above, utterly simple, uncompounded, and undefined. I think this muscle of the coal and the fire is in the Mimer Mayim Rabim. Were the powers of the soul to exist within its essence as distinct potentials, it would be a compounded entity. However, the fact that later the soul exhibits these powers compels us to say that they exist within its essence in some manner, abstract and rarefied as the level of existence is. Uch ma'etzem ha'nefesh shelemayla gamet ha'koychus atzmim ha'klulim boy. The essence of the soul transcends even the essential powers contained within it. Harehu noise be'atzmoy kol ha'koychus, and yet bears them all. The Rebbe Rishab uses the term bear to refer to the manner in which the essence of the soul contains the possibility. Yecholes is the term used in Chassidus for the different powers to later emerge and to exist in the abstract and rarefied manner described above. Within the essence of the soul, the power coalesces in total unity. Sha'arei ein sham koichos piratim klo. For on that rung, no separate particular powers exist. Af loy kimoi ha-koichos ha-atmiyim. Not even in a state of essential powers above the possibility for conscious expression. Shame. Something about within the soul. There's complete. Yes, but the complete essence, there's only unity. There's no separation. Yes. There's like your. If you look at it, it actually makes sense if you think about it. What is the neshama of every Jew? They say it's something we call mamish. It's a portion of God. Yeah, a chelek elaka mimam mamish, right? But every single Jew has that within him, and every single Jew, all the souls are all connected as one with God. That's what it's really trying to say. We all have a portion of God, but we're not separate portions of God. We're all together as one with God. Not even in a state of essential powers above the possibility for conscious expression. Shehem bilti mitzius nekeres. As the powers emerge from the soul's essence in their initial preliminary state of emanation, the soul's powers cannot be said to exist as discernible entities. Hey, Mark, what's discernible mean? You still there? Menachem Mordechai? So now I gotta go to dictionary.com now. I don't have a physical dictionary. Well, sometimes I go to Kindle. Let's see, I'm going to look up D-I-S-C-E-R. By the way, those that learn Hasidus through English, their vocabulary is going to get better on English too. So discernible, it's able to be discerned, it's perceptible. The scandal had no discernible effect on his career. What does it mean if something is discernible, able to be perceived in a sense? So something that is discernible is able to be perceived by a sense such as sight or smell or by the mind. It's able to be grasped. Okay. So now, as powers emerge from the soul's essence, in their initial preliminary state of emanation, the soul's power cannot be said to exist as discernible entities. Yeah, could you really grasp and sense and smell and see your soul and the power of the soul? Not really. That's like trying to physically see Hashem, unless you understand the concept that everything is Hashem. Then the question is, what can't you see that's not Hashem if everything is Hashem? But that's a whole nother conversation. Nevertheless, it's not graspable. It's not tangible. Nonetheless, in potentia, they exist as powers, as indicated by the term essential powers. Even this cannot be said regarding the existence of the powers within the essence of the soul. As mentioned, it is inappropriate to speak of any distinct potential existing within the essence of the soul. Nevertheless, it is a logical imperative that the essence includes the possibility for all the powers within itself. For all the powers do emanate from it. Thus, if they emanate from the essence of the soul, at the very least, a potential, abstract and rarefied as it may be for them, must exist within the essence. The Rebbe Rashab is describing in very concentrated wording two levels of the soul, which Chassidus describes at length in other sources. Nefesh nose koichos. The soul bears its powers, and koichos hakulim benefesh. The powers are included in the soul. Hey Chaim, is this in Tanya, or is this like the Rebbe Rashab revealing new stuff? Peel, are you still there? Like when I started, the closest thing I'm getting to this in Tanya is like they start talking about Soviv Kolomim and Mimalik Kolomim and stuff like that. This is, I don't know, it's that stuff that just gets beyond my head. But I feel like my... But I feel like they're, I feel like even when they use these terms, I'm still in a state of not understanding. Okay, so but I also feel like I feel like we need another Rebbe to explain what the Rebbe is saying. After Gilmo Thomas, is there anyone explaining what the Rebbe already taught? To- Now, every time I write to the Igros Kodesh, I keep getting the same answer. Do chinuch, 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 chinuch. It's a broken record. What do you think I'm doing now? What do you think I'm doing now? I'm doing chinuch. So how come the Rebbe's doing that if I'm doing what he's saying? How come he's still telling me to do it? Yeah, move to Cleveland. Bye bye. I don't know. Anyways, let's go further with a mimer. The level described as nefesh nosek kochos relates to the essence of the soul. On this lofty and abstract level, the powers of the soul are totally at one, both with the essence of the soul and with each other. It is not only that since their individual entities are not defined, they are not in conflict with each other. Instead, at this level, they sense, if that term can be used, themselves as expressions of the soul's essence and not as distinct powers. Therefore, the unity among them is consummate. Hey, Mark, what's consummate? Let's see. Consummate. According to consummate, and it's a verb. Whoa, I did not mean to start getting in this conversation. I just didn't know what he was saying. The proper way to say it without getting vulgar or stupid is to say unification. Bringing together. Like if you bring two Jews together and they build a Chabad house, that's being consummate. If you bring two different ideas together, so why is God talking about this with the soul? I mean, why is the Rebbe Rishab talking about this when the powers of the soul are doing that? There's no physical... I can keep going until everyone else is tired, but whatever. The level described as... The level described as nefesh nosech koichos relates to the essence of the soul. On this lofty and abstract level, the powers of the soul are totally at one, both with the essence of the soul and with each other. It is not that since their individual identities are not defined, they are not in conflict with each other. Instead, at this level, they sense, if that term can be used, themselves as expressions of the soul's essence and not as distinct powers. Therefore, the unity among them is consummate. Does that make sense?
Okay.
I think it's like building and connecting and bonding the powers of the soul. They're using the word consummate because just as a man and a woman has to be consummate to make a child, the souls have to be together to function properly. The soul has to be together with the Shem in order to function as the way Hashem wants it to function. Like when a Jew senses, oh God, I shouldn't go here. The food isn't kosher. I shouldn't do this Avera. It's really bad. That's because his soul is one with the Shem, and his soul is telling him not to do something. If he didn't have these proper soul faculties, he wouldn't be able to be guided in the right direction. As such, even when these powers emerge as distinct entities, they contain their antithesis in a concealed state. At a level below the soul's essence, its powers begin to emerge as separate entities. At this point, they are far from entering into a person's consciousness. This level is described as Koichos HaKlulim Benefesh. The difference between the first level and the second level is that the first focuses on the soul. Since the soul's potential is unbounded, it possesses the possibility of expression through different powers. However, the powers themselves do not exist. All that exists is the essence of the soul. On the second level, the focus is on the powers themselves. True, on this level of existence, they are not distinct entities, but rather included in the soul to the point where their own identity is entirely obscured. However, their independent potential already exists. Afterwards, as the powers begin to emerge on a conscious level, they are filtered through the medium of intellect. This causes them to be weakened and enables them to function in harmony with their antithetical power. These concepts are evident from the explanations that follow. Bitzarik loimar sheheim sham bibichinas hiskalus mamish shekulam heim devar echod mamish. This being so, it must be said that on the level described as nefesh nose koichlis, the powers are included in absolute synthesis in such a way that they are actually as one. Belishum hiskalus kilo eze hiskalus. With no distinctions at all, transcending any conception of differentiation whatsoever. The manner in which the potential for the soul's powers exists and its essence resembles the concept of Yachid. Yachid is together. As explained at length in Chassidus, when we proclaim God's oneness in the Shema, we describe him as Havaya Echod, the one God. Seemingly, it would be more... That's actually good to learn this, because now we have Kavana during... By learning this, we're going to have Kavana from Meyer tonight, because we're going to say Shema. Seemingly, it would be more appropriate to describe him as Havaya Yachid, a term which would emphasize his singular oneness, for it describes a uniquely sublime level of godliness, a rung above the entire framework of existence. There exist levels of godliness on which he relates to the various spiritual and physical entities brought into being. Havaya Yachid refers to him as he exists alone before his conception of these entities. However, in the Shema, the word echad is more appropriate. Echad, one, being a number implies the existence of other entities. A second, a third, etc. Similarly, the Shema emphasizes God's oneness with the created beings as they exist within their individual entities. For instance, right here, there is God and there's this entire creation. There's this entire world. There's you, there's me, there's the plants, the animals, and everything. There's like numerous infinite things. But why is it one? Because everything is butthole and nullified to the one God. As there is millions and trillions and infinite creations, they're all one to God. Nothing exists without Hashem. That's why the word Echad is used. What do you mean you're all of? That's your cave of kid. Okay. Well, if you look at the Shema, it's both levels, because there's also Yud-Kei Vav-Kei. So if there's Yud-Kei Vav-Kei and there's Elohim, that's just saying that God is within nature and above nature, coexisting at the same exact time. I learned the olive represented something else, but different and important. That the olive represents a yud above, a line down, and a yud below. The yud above is Hashem. The line down, the yud below is the Yehudi, the Jews, and the line down is the Torah and mitzvahs that connect us with Hashem. Well, we are all of because we are Adam. We're all Adam. Well, I think that the Jews don't ever feel that God isn't there. Just the Yetzirah tricks them and consoles them to do the Avera and says God will make it okay later and whatever, and that's the issue. But let's go forward. However, in the Shema, the word Echad is more appropriate. Echad, one being a number, implies the existence of other entities, a second, a third, etc. Similarly, the Shema emphasizes God's oneness with the created beings as they exist within their individual entities. Nevertheless, we are compelled to say that even as God is Yachid, similarly one, his being allows for the potential for all existence, albeit in a uniquely abstract manner. In a somewhat similar manner, the essence of the soul includes within the possibility for the different soul powers that emerge from it. Umishum ze. Therefore, an example, because they exist in a state of oneness within the soul's essence and are subsumed within the soul, seeing themselves, as it were, as expressions of it. Kam behak koichos kimoy shehim bivichi naspiratzim. Even when the powers descend to the level where they exist as individual entities, yesh behel leim bechol koyach mehakoyach ha-hafki. Each includes its antithesis in a concealed state. Fundamentally, every one of the soul's powers is not an individual entity, but an expression of the soul. This is also true of the antithetical power. It also is a fundamentally an expression of the essence of the soul. Accordingly, every potential has the space within it to include a potential that is antithetical to their own being. And since that antithetical potential is also an expression of the essence of the soul, it can exist within the other power. Mitzad ha'his kalus shelahem shebi v'chinas ha'atzmus chuli. The possibility for the conclusion results from their existence in a state of synthesis in the soul's essence. Chassidus uses the following example to illustrate the concept of equality being included in its antithesis. Our sages praise those who experience joy in suffering, like Rabbi Akiva. Suffering is obviously the opposite of joy. However, when a person appreciates the positive outcome from the suffering he experiences and the lofty divine source from which it emanates, he can experience joy. Uch Moshehu Bechoychois HaNefesh. This concept applies not only in regard to the soul's powers, Kimoy Chenhu Bechol Devar, but to every component of existence. Uch Moimayim Yeshboy Beheleim Gam Yisoid HaEsh. For example, fire exists hidden within the water in an elemental state. Bechem Be'esh Yesh Misoid HaMayim. And fire, in turn, contains water in an elemental state. Ela shehu be'elim me'oid b'sachlis ha'elim, ha'elim. However, in each case, the existence of the antithesis is entirely indiscernible. It is utterly concealed. Uchmei shehu begilui. In their revealed states, Hare Yisoid Hamayim Hu Mayim Levar Levad. The element of water is solely water. Be Yeshar Lehis Chaber Kaloim Ha'esh. And it cannot coalesce with fire at all. So we got like 2.5 pages left. Not too much longer. You guys can bear with me. B'chein ha'esh e'eshtar li'iskaber im hamayim. Similarly, fire cannot coalesce with water. B'chein mipnei she'ha'esh she'bamayim hu b'sachlis ha'elim. The rationale is that the elemental dimension of fire that exists in water is in a state of ultimate hiddenness. So you see what's going on with these elements? The fire that exists within water is butzel, so that way water can exist. And likewise, with the element of water, the fire that's in it is butzel, so that way the water can exist and be water. Because everything has a combination of all the four elements. V'lachin yishar loy mishum ze lehischaber im ha'esh. Therefore, for this reason, water cannot join together with fire. Liyois behis galus hu mayim pishutim chuli. For in its revealed state, it is simple water. Uchmoichen hu bisoit ha'esh chuli. Similar concepts apply to the element of fire. Amnam kishem chal kim es hamayim. However, when water is broken into fundamental components, the elemental dimension of fire that was within it is extracted and revealed. Similarly, from fire, when the water contained within it is extracted. Shezehu inyan ma shekasuv b'sever yitzira hoitzi esh mimayim umayim me'esh. This is the meaning of the statement in Sefer Yitzira. He extracted fire from water and water from fire. Az yichoylim lehis chaver ulehis kalel yachad chuli. The two elements can at this point coalesce. Ki ha'esh shebamayim im hamayim shebaesh yichoylim lehischaber. The fire within water and the water within fire can coalesce. Ba'al yedei ze mischaberim hamayim im ha'esh. And in this way, water can be joined with fire. Ki hamayim al yedei shemechalkim oisoy lachalakim. This is possible because when water is broken into its fundamental components, umoitzim boy hakoyach haha ki, and its opposite quality is discovered within, al yidei ze nechlas koychoy. Its distinctive power is weakened. Uchmoy chen haesh. The same is true in the case of fire. Just keep going to the same idea that the fire that has a little bit of water, the water is weakened to such an extent that the fire can be a fire. And vice versa. Ah yideha rada behahis chalkus. Through being separated and broken into its fundamental components, shemoitzim boy hahav ki Nechelash Gam Kain. Its opposite quality is revealed, and it is explained above regarding water, is weakened. Be'az Yecholim Lehischaber Yachar Chuli. Then this weakening makes it possible for the two opposing elements to come together. Be'nimsa Dehahis Chalkus. Hazois he davka sibas, hahis kalus kuli. Thus, it is this division that is the cause of their mutual incorporation. With examples in this chapter, the Rebbe Rashab illustrates the principle he stated in the previous chapter, that when entities are fundamentally one, division will enable a more perfect unity. As the different qualities exist within the essence of the soul, the level of nefesh, nose, koichos, described above, they coexisted in a state of oneness. This was possible because their individual natures had yet to be expressed. When they are brought together and synthesized, explained here, they are joined in oneness, even as their different and opposite natures have been revealed. Okay, we just now finished a chapter, and this is the Kitzur. Kitzur is summary. Bechoychos ha'atzmim be'esh u'mayim u'v'chol devar. Within each of the essential powers, similarly within fire and water, and in every element of existence, yesh be'elem gam mehipuchoy. They're just its antithesis in a concealed state. All yidei ha'his chalkus b'gilui he'elem zeh. Through a process of division, this hidden quality can be revealed, and yicholim lehis kalil. The two elements may coalesce, achieving a more perfect unity, for their oneness exists even as they have emerged as individual entities. And now we just finished the chapter. Anybody want to say anything about this idea? It got very scientific at the end. What time is it now? Let's see. 10:36. We did cover the hour. I'm willing to bring in everything if people are still down for it. If you guys are tired, if we can end this year. It's up to you guys. I'm telling you, Mark, you gotta get this device. It's really cool. Holds the book, it holds the phone, it holds the tablet. It's pretty amazing. Because technically, I could use it for my tablet. I could use it for my Kindle. A taco. This isn't because you're so lazy that you can't pick up a phone. This is because